from CERN IT. I was supposed to do this presentation with Ricardo Rocha, but he couldn't make it. So we'll do it alone this time. I will present how we manage at CERN in our Kubernetes clusters, secrets, and a bit of charts. And I will talk also a little bit about CERN. So in this picture, you can see the globe. This is doesn't participate in any of the experiments. It's just an exhibition center. But on the back, with a big graffiti of the detector, you can see the Atlas experiment. So what is CERN? CERN is a particle physics laboratory, and it was and it still is a peace project. It was founded in 1954 by 12 member states in Europe, and it was meant to concentrate and force, in a way, all the countries to collaborate for nuclear research and not start a thermonuclear war after World War II. The annual budget is around 100 million Swiss francs, and now we have 23 member states and around 4,500 members of staff and 30,000 collaborative scientific users all around the world. As you can see, we have many countries like the United States, Russia, India, and so on that are either observing the organization or their associate members. The heart of the experiment and its actual mission, apart from just research, is to run the accelerator. This is the Large Hadron Collider, and you can see Geneva Lake in Geneva on the surface and 100 meters underground. You can see the Large Hadron Collider with 27 kilometers of circumference, and the four experiments, Atlas, CMS, the many ones, LHCb ALICE, and a couple of more that are also leveraging the beams that the accelerator generates. This is in greater detail of what the accelerator does. So the beam is injected here with proton electrons, protons of electrons. It is accelerating the proton synchrotron, which is one, it was the first accelerator. And then it goes to the super proton synchrotron that is accelerated even more higher velocity. And then it is injected, if it has enough momentum, to the LHC, which reaches nearly the speed of light. Then in these four red dots that you can see the main experiments, the beams collide and generate collisions, which are the main source of data for us. So each experiment, in each of the four points, 40 million times per second, particles collide and generate 1.6 megabytes of data. There are three levels of trigger farms, which is hardware. So in the first trigger farm, which is like a special dedicated hardware for this, we have a reduction of data like 400 times. Then we have the second level, which is 50 times, and then 30 times reduction of data. In the end, out of the four experiments, we generate 65 gigabytes per second when the accelerator runs, and we store about 70 petabytes per year. Now let's dive into containers, and we'll get back to physics, which is more exciting from the people that I've talked around today, after Helm and Kubernetes. So at CERN, we run a private cloud, and we have a container service. Our cloud is based on OpenStack, and as you can see, we have an unhealthy amount of cores, like around 300,000. We have 33,000 VMs running, and we have almost 500 container clusters. Most of them, as you can see here at the bottom, are Kubernetes clusters, and we have some Swarm that are keep reducing over time. For Kubernetes, we have around 1,800 nodes, but these are spread across different teams. Some of them are tiny clusters that are just used for CI/CD and they don't run services, but there are others that run production services that I will describe later. So what are the use cases? As I said, the main use case is physics analysis, which is batch processing or end-user analysis. So when we store events, these events don't have a lot of meaning if you just take the data points, and these events must be reconstructed from different points collected by the different detectors in one of the big experiments. So the biggest one is batch processing, which is 80% of the capacity, but then we have end-user analysis, like in Jupyter Notebooks, which are very popular. It's a very popular way for physicists to trade even data, but also algorithms. But also now we have started to explore machine learning, which is with increased performance of GPUs that are more relevant and important for doing physics analysis. But then we also have traditional use cases like infrastructure management, data movement, web services, platforms, and continuous integration, and so on. And of course, as we are in the cloud team, at least me, we eat our own food, and we run also OpenStack on Kubernetes on OpenStack and so on. So what about our on-premise Kubernetes clusters? As I said, we have a small API service that creates clusters on demand, and inside it installs a couple of components like metric server, all the usual monitoring stack for Kubernetes, traffic or Nginx or AC Prox that we are exploring recently. We have some integration with our identity service at CERN, which is backed by Active Directory, and the interface is also with OpenStack. But we also have some storage plugins like CVMFS, which is stands for CERN VM File System, that it's a way for physicists to share code. And CephFS, which you already know, it's a shared file system backed by Ceph. And Manila, which is again a small API service to carve shares in CephFS and hand them to users. Also, we have CERN before the cloud was using the grid, so every node also has an identity based on a GitHub and a grid certificate. Reaching Helm eventually. So all of these clusters, all the Kubernetes clusters, have a system tiller, as we call it, which is a tiller running in a dedicated namespace that is managed by the cloud team. This tiller has the admin role because we need to create roles, cluster roles, and role bindings. For example, you cannot install the metric server if you don't have some role bindings, or the Prometheus operator. It has also some RBAC requirements. Of course, we try to follow all the best practices around securing tiller with TLS enabled. And we also only execute them. We only interact with Tiller from inside the cluster. So you must submit a job or a pod that has the certificates of Tiller and talk to Tiller to deploy something new. As I said, well, for automation, the plugins are deployed as jobs inside this namespace. And we recommend to users to use either their own Tiller or Helm 3 beta recently. We didn't suggest them to use alpha, but from beta, we say it's almost in its final form. Regarding secret management, so as soon as we started, as the Kubernetes service that we have started to getting popular, the biggest questions that we had from users was what should we do about secrets? So are we just storing Kubernetes secrets? And okay, if they're stored in the cluster, where should be stored outside? Like only people will push the secrets inside the cluster? So we try to draft some requirements. So before Kubernetes in the cloud world, we were using mostly Puppet. And for Puppet, we had like the GitOps paradigm. If you wanted to do a change, you would submit to a repo. And then the CI would trigger the Puppet agent to run in the nodes and apply changes, change password, and so on. For Kubernetes, we didn't have something from day one. So we wanted to have the GitOps workflow. We wanted to not change the upstream charts, so we didn't want to create a CRD. So we just wanted like the minimum possible changes. And we also wanted users to use the CLI of Helm, either from CI or as people. And to store all the secrets somewhere centrally, or an encryption key for the secrets to leverage the existing infrastructure, like for key storage and authentication authorization. OpenStack yet provides another service which is called Barbican, and this Helm plugin leverages this service. So a user fetches the symmetric key from Barbican locally, the client does it for him. Then it detects that there is an encrypted values file in Base64 format, it decodes it, it decrypts it, and then you can send it to the cluster. And if you want to do the opposite direction, if you add a new password or a new secret, it encrypts it, it writes it in the file system, and then you can push to Git and have like a Git workflow. So this tool is very small, like less than 100 lines. It's written in Go, and it provides a wrapper around the install, upgrade, and lint commands that I will show right after. So here what it looks like. If you just we just name it secrets. So you do Helm secrets manage help, and you can see that we have the crypt encrypt that users should not need. You have view that you can view the encrypted file, edit that opens Vim, I think nano not only Vim. So good luck with that. And then you have install, lint, and upgrade. We're missing template, but we will also add template. Or maybe it's also added, didn't follow the last release that we do internally. But as you would do Helm install, and you would pass some values, you would do Helm secrets install, and it decrypts for you the secrets, and then pass them to Helm. This is how the workflow looks like. So services secrets.yaml is encrypted in the file system, but with view you can see it. And then you do Helm secrets install. Here you can pass some normal values, like a YAML file, and here is the encrypted file that is decrypted on the fly in shared memory and sent to Tiller. Of course, then you can do edit, and it will pop up Vim for you to do changes, and then you can do upgrade and so on. A few words about the charts that we are running. Most of the charts that we use are from stable from upstream. So this covers like 80 or 90% of the use cases, but we have some custom charts that we need. The code is hosted, it's public, so we are an open organization, so everyone can benefit from this. In gitl.ch/helmstarcharts, and there we have like mirrors from the upstream charts, and some mirrors for the OpenStack ones, and some dedicated in the CERN directory. To share all this, we have S3 at CERN, so we have some dedicated buckets for each of these repositories. And recently we started also using Chart Museum, so we use S3 and Chart Museum at the moment in conjunction. But also S3 is backed, Chart Museum is backed by S3, so soon we will stop using directly S3 just Chart Museum. The most prominent custom chart that we have is EOS XD. EOS is an internal but open source file system that most of the physics data are in, and physicists that do analysis in their data, they fetch them from EOS, and it can mount workspaces. It means that these are bigger volumes in EOS for multiple hundreds of terabytes that users can share, but there are also some home directories for personal projects or like private data. Since we are a physics lab that is created since many years, we're using HD Condor for batch jobs. I think only old people would know this. But we also created a Helm chart to run StartD, which is like the kubelet of Condor that runs in every node. And then we can have Kubernetes to have all the monitoring and all the benefits from Kubernetes. And on top, we can run Condor to schedule jobs. Most of the plugins that we're using, we port them to Helm because it's much easier to manage them and package them and have only a very small interface with parameters that users need to configure. This is an example that we contributed upstream or collaborated upstream for CFFS, and we are dropping like the traditional manifests and we are moving to this one. Work in progress that we still have, we are still in like not baby steps, but in one of the first steps of using Helm, but it picks up very fast, and most users, our users that consume the cloud, are using Helm to package their application. They're not just using manifests. We want to move all this system and plugins and storage components in one umbrella chart, so then we will release only this one, and we can tell users to have one single values file to manage the different plugins that we want. And that usually they need to change only a couple of parameters, like literally two or three, instead of having a very big manifest for them to carry around and potentially make mistakes. OpenStack is a very fragmented project. It has many microservices, so we're gradually moving them into Helm. It's been a challenge because if you're upstream, if you have collaborated with the OpenStack Helm community, you will see that the charts are very big, like multiple thousands of lines of templates, and that's like a showstopper for us. And the next part is move completely to GitOps. We already started investigating into Flux, but we haven't, let's say, make it production, and we don't suggest it to users just yet. Quick summary. Almost all plugins, or the majority of plugins, are installed with Helm 2. We want to move as soon as possible to Helm 3 to avoid having Tiller and all this strange configuration. So if you want to change something after, afterwards, you must submit a job or a pod in the cluster and interact with Tiller. So Kubernetes RBAC will solve this. And packaging apps is like, Helm is the best for this. Since we have all the infrastructure for S3 and CERN Museum now, it's very easy to package an app and share it inside the organization. And most Kubernetes users that we have are packaging their apps with Helm. Here are some references, good reads and or presentations that I would like you to follow if you want. The first one is a better write-up or a more extended version of what I described for the Helm plugin and also the code in GitHub. You can also contribute using Helm to doing analysis of LHC data with volunteering computing using Boink. It's similar to SETI at home. If you know SETI at home, you can, if you have a Kubernetes cluster and you want to pay more money to a cloud provider, you can install our chart and it will consume all the capacity if you leave it. Also, the next part of the presentation, like the second part of this presentation, is already accepted at KubeCon San Diego, which is managing all the deployments that I described with Flux and with a GitOps paradigm. That's it for Helm. Now we'll move briefly to use cases that we have and then a shameless plug for the open days that are coming this weekend. One of the biggest and most intensive in compute use cases is running Spark on Kubernetes. Apart from EOS that I mentioned in CVMFS, we also have Hadoop, of course, because and Ceph, because we have them all. And the data analytics working group has worked in packaging Spark and integrated with EOS and Hadoop. And they're providing a solution that users can go into the cloud service, create a Kubernetes cluster for 1 week or so, deploy Spark, run the a big analysis, and then destroy all the resources. And this is one of the first this is one of the services that created headaches in the data center because it's so intense in compute and also network. They download so many data that it almost brought down many other services that were co-located with it. But it's one of the most impressive ones that we had so far. This is a very useful for everyone in the world to benefit from the analysis that it's done in CERN. So Rihanna and Rika start the data preservation projects. So all the analysis that it's done in different labs in the world, also at CERN, the results are stored, and all the steps to reproduce this analysis are stored inside in the open data portal. So with this stack, the Invenio working group has created a platform that everyone can access it, retrieve physics data, and if they have enough capacity and storage, they can reproduce and they can even rediscover the Higgs boson if they want in their own infrastructure. This is the one that I mentioned already, and it even from the slides of my colleagues have the Helm logo there. This was done like last year. This was to deploy HD Condor on top of Kubernetes, and all the components like console, SSSD, and startd for Condor are managed by Helm charts, and their benefit for all the plugins that I mentioned already. And the final one, this is not specific to CERN. It's we have a lot of business logic in WebLogic from Oracle. And one of the recent projects that the team that manages WebLogic did was to migrate from virtual machines to Kubernetes, the whole stack. This was the first use case that reached production, and a lot of the procedures that we have internally, like signing documents, is running on Kubernetes. They recently started using Helm. This slide was created like 6 months ago. It was WAP and to remove that, but neither is using Helm as well. I think they're using even Helm 3, not Helm 2. And the last one, this is really work in progress. Maybe it also hit the news recently that we're moving to an open source solution for our mail infrastructure. And part of this service will run on Kubernetes. And already they're using a few of the plugins in Helm, and they're packaging the Kopano mail service also in Helm. That's it. And now the plug. This weekend is the CERN Open Days. This weekend at CERN is dedicated and it's open to the public. So everyone that wants to travel to Geneva or is around the area can visit it. At the top we have the CMS detector, and one of these people can be you. And at the bottom is the antimatter factory and the ELENA experiment that creates positrons and antiprotons, and studies also the properties of antimatter when it's exposed to gravity. You can visit opendays.cern for more information. And you don't have to register necessarily, but it's better to register before to secure one of the visits in one of the experiments. Otherwise, you will be on the surface and move visiting visiting points that are less packed, let's say. That's it. Thank you. If you have any questions about Helm or Open Days, you can shoot.
Yes. Do you have any plans of supporting other backends in that plugin other than Barbican?
We're investigating. Another team that is deploying services in the IT department is investigating to use Vault. So if we have Vault available, which will be integrated eventually with the identity management that we have, it will also support Vault. But the interface with the key storage service is very small. It just retrieves the secret and then sort of storage back or updates it. Thank you.